walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Your perfect love is casting a fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh, no, you never let go through the cold and through the storm.
Mission there. We're going to be having a meeting next weekend to talk some more about that. So for anyone who's interested to come and find out more about being a participant, it will be the last weekend of July, July 28 through 31, Friday through Monday. One of my very favorite things that I get to do each year. And so I hope that many others will be able to join with us, and it'll be really, really special time. Also, welcome to anyone worshiping with us for the first time, and we invite you to get one of the colorful bags on the table in the entry that has homemade cookies, as well as information about Christ the Servant. We hope it would be helpful to you. And please take note of the announcements that are printed in the back of the worship folder. As I mentioned, next week, talking more about Mexico, meetings about that, And then also we have the women's group will be meeting on February 8th, Wednesday, and we'll be doing sharing favorite Bible verse. We'll be meeting in this building on that occasion. But please check out all those other announcements, and we'll continue in our worship.
Please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Rejoice.
Rejoice.
Praise.
We will praise.
Glory.
We sing glory.
Lift your voice.
Glory to God in the highest. Sing glory to God on the earth. Glory to God in the highest. Sing glory to God on the earth. We give to you all our praise. With hearts and voices all our days. Our lives of thankfulness we bring. Gather together, hear us sing. Glory to God in the highest. Sing glory to God on the earth. Glory to God in the highest. Sing glory to God on the earth. Jesus Christ, God's only Son, victory over death you won. Take away the sins of all. Give us to life and hear us call. Glory to God in the highest. Sing glory to God on the earth. Glory to God in the highest. Sing glory to God on the earth. Holy Spirit,
for the kids to come on up.
All right. Well, good morning.
I better delete that part from the video for the online posting.
Okay. So I want you to echo me for just a moment, okay? So do justice. Love kindness. Walk humbly with your God. Okay, we're going to do that a little more together. Do justice, love kindness. Walk humbly with your God. All right, you just did a Bible verse. That's Micah chapter 6, verse 8. Now, love kindness. What can you do to show kindness to someone? Yeah. Okay, don't be mean if someone's been mean to you, okay? Okay, so you just try to be not judging someone else, right? Okay, good, all right. If someone falls, you can help them up. Okay, what's another kind thing? To give them a hug or a kiss, I like that, yeah. Respect the Bible, that's good, yeah. Compliment someone. I like that. That's a very nice way to show kindness. Thank you, you guys. Okay, another one. Yeah, just helping them when they feel like they've been hurt, helping them feel better. Yes. okay, when someone's mean to you, don't be mean back, because you know that's not right. You guys are awesome. You guys have wonderful ideas and understanding of what kindness is. And that's what God wants from us. God says, love kindness. That's what God is asking for us to do. All right, well, thank you. So I hope today especially you can do that. You can do your best to show kindness to each other, to others. All right, well, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your love and kindness towards us, sending Jesus to be our Savior. Help us to show love and kindness to each other. We pray through Jesus, our friend, our Lord, and our Savior. Amen. Thank you. You can get a sticker on your way to Sunday school. And I should mention another love and kindness was the Girl Scouts who put together baby bassinets yesterday from items that were donated, and also in particular from our church. People brought in a lot of items to help put together in those baby bassinets. And we continue with our scripture reading.
Read from the prophet Micah, the 6th chapter. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember what the king Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Psalm 15. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Those who lead a blameless life and do what is right, who speak the truth from their heart.
They do not slander with their tongue. They do no evil to their friends. They do not cast.
In their sight the wicked are rejected, but they honor those who fear the Lord. They do not give their money in hope of gain, nor do they take bribes against the innocent. We read from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. St. Paul writes, "For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. Please stand.
Matthew chapter 5. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. As I was reading over and reflecting on the Bible passages that we have for this weekend, the word that came to my mind was unexpected, that in each of them, in some way, God either acts in an unexpected way or God asks us to act in some manner that is just kind of unexpected, kind of different from the way the world would usually act. And with that, my brain went on a very weird divergent thought track, which when I had the word unexpected in my head, I thought of Peter Sellers and the Pink Panther movies and how he used to have his servant Cato try to jump out randomly at unexpected times and unexpected places to attack him so that he would be prepared for anything at any time. So I have no idea, that has nothing to do with the scripture, but that's where unexpected took me. But unexpected, sometimes again, how God calls us to act can be unexpected, or also the way God acts can seem rather unexpected. The first passage we have is from Micah, is just a really great Bible passage, and especially that verse 8, to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. I was, several months ago, I was pulling through the bank, drive-through line or whatever, and I saw a car parked in the parking lot at the bank, and you see the license plates, and you're thinking, like, well, what does that say? What is that supposed to mean? And it just said Micah 68, and I was like, Micah 68, and all of a sudden I went, Micah 6 verse 8, to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. I was like, wow, someone put that as their license plate. Do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with your God. And I'm going to repeat that a lot of times today, so you're going to start getting that in your head. I would like to meet that person. I didn't have the opportunity. I didn't walk inside the bank and go, okay, who's got the license plate? But I just thought that was really, really special that someone actually made that into their license plate. Well, before we get to that wonderful verse, though, the situation is that apparently God's people were kind of grumbling, kind of complaining, like, God, where are you? Why aren't you helping us? And so they're complaining against God. So God, in essence, says, okay, well, you're complaining against me. Let's go to court. Let's take this issue to court. And, so we'll call for our jury the mountains and the hills. Well, I have to say, that's a little bit unfair of God, because who made the mountains and the hills? God made the mountains and the hills. But anyway, then God presents a defense. God says, well, let's see. You think I don't care for you. I've rescued you from slavery in Egypt. I gave you great leaders, Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. I protected you, kept you safe through all those 40 years journeying in the wilderness. I brought you to your promised land. I brought you your home. Okay. Now tell me I haven't done anything for you. So the people, they repent. They their hearts are turned. And so they, oh, Lord, what should we do? What should we do to express this? And what offering should we bring? What can we do? What can we bring? And so they start out with a relatively high bar, a calf. A calf was not a cheap offering by any means. But then it starts to multiply and multiply and multiply to this kind of, hyperbolic. I mean, not meant seriously, but to the extreme of saying, offer my firstborn child, but God says, no, that's not what I want. I don't want your offering. I want you, yourself, your life, to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with your God. I want that to be your offering. And so that's the unexpected thing. They thought, here's what we've been taught in our religious life. Here are the offerings that we can bring. And God says, no, I want you. I want your life. That's your offering. Well, then we hear in Corinthians how God acted unexpectedly because of the cross. The cross confused many, many people. Paul says it confused the people of the Greek world who were used to their philosophy in which the divine being were aloof. They were always far from this world, far from its suffering and its pain. And to think that a divine being would become human, would suffer, would die on a cross, that was just hard for them to understand. It just didn't make sense in their view of what the deity was. The deity would not suffer. The deity would not have such compassion for humanity, for human beings. And in the Jewish mind, the Messiah was to be a hero, riding into Jerusalem with horses and soldiers and throwing out the Roman oppressor and reestablishing the kingdom. But their Messiah died on a cross. It didn't quite fit to many people's expectation. God had acted in such an unexpected way. And even still, the cross is not easy by any means to grasp. It's only with God's Holy Spirit that we begin to see in new eyes, when we begin to see from God's way of looking. I have to back up for a second. I forgot one of my own little segues in my message. Back to do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. Gives me another chance to say it. For the past month, we have been lifting up, the Lord sends me to be in the world too. And again, to live that out, to do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with our God. And people wrote on little papers and put that out there in the lobby, and really appreciate how people responded in that way. And it's because it's a reminder how God works in us, in all of us together, to bring God's goodness, to bring God's love and kindness into our world. And so just to kind of lift us all up and mention some of the things that by God working in us, we do bring into our world is reaching out to new neighbors, sponsoring persons with addiction, making soap for hope toiletry bags for homeless, give courage to young struggling readers, hospital volunteer, take yarn and create things to keep people warm. I have to admit, with our weather lately, that one really kind of was like, oh, yeah, that's good. Water system, support water system in Liberia. A tour guide or educator and educator for Clark County Wetlands. Help homeless. Rescue animals. And there are many, many more. I just kind of plucked some of those out. And it's a reminder again that God's kindness flows in and through us into our world, into our neighborhoods. And so thank you for doing that. Well, so God and the cross, it is something that caught people and surprised them in many ways. But also what Paul was trying to get across in this, I will admit, somewhat circuitous thing to follow when he's written in this passage. But another important part of it is a reminder that we don't save ourselves. We are not the author of our salvation. That is what God has done for us through Jesus Christ, and he did that by way of the cross. It is not by our own power. It is not by our own success. It is not by our own money. It is not by our endeavor that we are saved, but it is a gift to us from God through Jesus Christ. And so that it is through Jesus Christ that we receive the wisdom of God, the righteousness, the sanctification, redemption. That is what God gives to us through Jesus Christ. Well, today we get to hear from the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus shares his message with first his disciples and the others who have come to crowd around. And it starts out with what we know as the Beatitudes. The Beatitudes. Now, I will admit, I will probably my whole life keep coming back to the Beatitudes and still learn new things or still get a new perspective. Every time I come to them, it somehow touches something that I hadn't quite realized. And one of the things that caught me this time was I have tended to always see the future tense. And there is future tense in there. Will be, will be, will be, right? That's in there. But part of it, and this is really important, and you might want to actually turn and look in here, is that he begins with the phrase, Jesus says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And then kind of almost at the end, again, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." I always thought that was something that is out there yet for us, right? We'll get there. It's now. The word is. Is is present tense. Is means right now. Currently, this is happening, right? So we are already in the kingdom of God. That is already ours. we already belong in God's realm, in God's family. So that is already true. It's not something that we're waiting for. Now, some of those blesseds also do use the future, you know, talking things like, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. And that's still good news. That's still good news. You know, one of the twists in this blessed thing is when you hear, again, the unexpected aspect is, blessed are those who mourn. That's not the way we would tend to look at it, right? No, you know, sorrowful, unfortunate are those who mourn, really, is what we would tend to think. But blessed, how is it that one is still blessed? Well, one of it is the reassurance is that it's given, you will be comforted. There will be comfort. You will not mourn unceasingly and forever. There will be comfort. But even in the midst of it, there is already hope, because the blessedness is not the situation, that's not the blessing, but that God is with us even in the midst of the situation. And so still one is blessed because God is with us. Not the situation is good, but God is with us, and therefore we are still blessed, even in the midst of those kind of difficult situations and challenges. But still, what Jesus says here does, you know, turn a little bit upside down the way we would look at things from the world's perspective, from the world's point of view. It's, you know, it doesn't quite jive with where we think goodness and happiness lie. But we are invited to follow Jesus, and this is the way Jesus chose. Now, again, by the world's perspective, they might look at this and say, ugh, how could you live that way? No one can really live that way. It's just not possible. Well, I came across something as I was reading about the Beatitudes, and it talks about power, and the title of the book is not actually Anti-Beatitudes, but that's kind of what I would title it. The book was written a few years back, and it was called 48 Laws of Power, which I will now still subtitle Anti-Beatitudes. And so what the authors had done is they'd looked at history, they'd looked at powerful people, and they had distilled out of this 48 laws of power. Now here are some of these laws that they had come up with. Law number 2, never put too much trust in friends. Learn how to use enemies. Law number 11, learn to keep people dependent on you. Law 13, when you ask for help, appeal to people's self-interest, never to their mercy or gratitude. Law 14, pose as a friend, work as a spy. Law 33, discover each person's thumbscrew. Now, I'll ask you, which laws would you rather live by? Those or what Jesus said? It's pretty clear to me. I think it stands out. And Jesus guides us into the way of mercy, into the way of peace, into the way of forgiveness, into the way of building community and not tearing it down, not tearing down others. Well, living that way isn't easy, though. I mean, there's no doubt that it is challenging. But Jesus showed us the way. Jesus lived this way. And he gives us his power to continue to walk in his footsteps. Even sometimes in amazing ways. And I was reminded of a situation where a very young girl, this was actually turned into a movie by Disney, but her name's Ruby Bridges, and she's 7 years old. African American, and this was several years ago. This was when in New Orleans they were just starting to do desegregation of schools. So she was the first one to be going to her school, African American going to an all-white school. And so this was the first day, and there were federal marshals there to protect because there were just crowds of adults who were just screaming hateful things at her. But before she walked into the building, she paused and she bowed her head and she prayed. And then a reporter asked her afterwards, what were you praying for? What were you praying about? And she said, I was praying for the people who were screaming at me. And he was just kind of shocked. You were praying for the people who were screaming at you, who were yelling at you? And she said, yeah. My mama taught me that when people speak mean of you, you pray for them just like Jesus prayed for the people who spoke mean of him. That's purity of heart. Amen.
Please, we join together to share our faith, sharing in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we join together in prayer, I would just like to mention in a special request for you to continue prayers for Patrick Olson, who had to, a teenager who had to be taken by ambulance to hospital last night, and he's in the ICU. Guided by the light of Christ, who has been made known to the nations, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all people in need. For Christ's church on earth and those who proclaim the good news of the kingdom, that all divisions cease. Lord, we give you praise, for you always hear us. For sky and sea, fish and bird, and the beauty of the whole creation, that God's goodness be seen through our everyday surroundings. Lord, we give you praise, for you always hear us. For our political and social leaders, that they use their power justly, and for all the nations of the world, that peace and understanding prevail. Lord, we give you praise, for you always hear us. For all who call upon the Lord for help, those dealing with illness or suffering, especially we pray for Howard and Elise, Ruth, Jane, Diane, Carrie, Elizabeth, Frank, Butch, Ray, Pat, Terry, Joan, Lou, Nancy, Laura, Kelly, Patrick, Melissa, Cole, Shirley, William, Mike, Nancy, Felix, Howard, Sandy, Lou, Carol Ann, Ann, Edward, Katrina, Danielle, Mark, Greg, Jane, Bill, Gary, Marguerite, Patsy, Susan, Lori, Alex, Amy, Hope, Jen, Lorraine, Riley, Taylor, Tegan, the Heidi family, Dr. Wall and family, and those whom we name in our hearts before your throne of grace. Surround them with your light and your love. Lord, we give you praise, for you always hear us. Radiant God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent. for the sake of the one who has made his dwelling among us, for your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please stand up to walk around to share the peace of our Lord. Continue in our worship with our offering.
Give you thanks and praise.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." We pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. I invite our communion ministers to come forward, and I would ask that we would have 5 communion ministers to help us in serving communion.
Please stand. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Share that peace with each other. Greet at least four people. Extra points if you greet anyone who's friendly.